to make a declaration. I encourage you guys to make this declaration before you study the Word of God of Elohim, before you even go to sleep, and ask Him to just open up your understanding to the sacred things of His text, because He's always speaking to us. He's always speaking to us. So together, let's say this: God, Ainai ve'abita, niflaot mitoratecha. Unveil my eyes that I might behold wondrous signs from your Torah. You know, we make many declarations all the time, and there's nothing better than to make the declarations of Scripture. So my prayer is this every single day, every moment, every time I open up the Word of Elohim, I always ask, and I declare this at the same time. The next one is from right to left. Odecha a ki norot nifleti niflaim asecha nafshi yodaat meod. Altogether, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. Sometimes we need to remind ourselves of that, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. There has never been anybody like you on the planet. There has never been anybody like you, and there never will be. All right, so let's look at this. I want to give you guys something that I shared a long time ago in connection with the Star of David, the Magid David. And it's pretty interesting. It has to do with the Hebrew alphabet. Let's do a crash course Hebrew alphabet class right now. Repeat after me. Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet, Hey, Vav, Zion, Chet, Tet, Yud, Kaf, Lamed, Mem, Nun, Samech, Ain, He, Tzadi, Kuf, Resh, Shin, Tav. Now you say it backwards. Those letters you just mentioned right now are the creative forces of all of creation, whether spiritual or natural. So very important. I want to show that embedded in the Star of David, which has been given a very bad rap. But I want to show you guys, embedded in the Magen David, which you see in water crystals, which you see when frequencies of healing are sounded out, and it's been proven scientifically that if something is so evil, then why does the very creation itself form itself at a molecular level in the shape of the Magen David, of the Star of David? I don't think there's anything evil about it. All right, so let's look at this. Can anybody see the letter inside of that? It's the letter Mem. And I put that one first because this letter, I love this letter. No spiritual or mystical meaning why I put it up there first, but I love the letter Mem. But let's look at this. Can you guys see that from right to left? Aleph. You guys name them off. This is a quick crash course Aleph Bet class. Aleph, come on, go. Okay, let's start over. You guys are really sleepy now. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Aleph. Bob, it's a test. Some of you died off. What happened here? We haven't even gotten into the Torah portion yet. The earth hasn't opened up yet. Come on. Here we go. Yud. Bob. Amen. Cool. Resh, Shin, Tav, and these are Sofites at the end. But isn't that amazing how the alphabet is inside the Star of David? I wanted to give you guys that just as a heads up, because in this week's Torah portion, we're going to wind up looking at letters, we're going to look at connections numerically, and deeper messages inside of the Torah portion, along with the simplicity and the simple text of this week's Torah portion. Korach. Can you guys say that? Korach.
Korach.
In Ezekiel 20, verse 38, you can jot it down. You can just look at it if you want and read it. It says this: "And I will purge out from among you the rebels and those who disobey against me. I will bring them forth out of the land where they live, but they shall not enter into the land of Israel. and you shall know that I am YHVH. You will know that I am the Lord, or you will know that I am Yahweh. You will know. Father, we just thank you for this week's Torah portion. I pray and I ask, Abba, that your Ruach would move through me as your Ruach, your Spirit, move through me all week long to prepare this Torah portion. So, Father, we submit all of our ways to you right now. I submit myself specifically, Father, as a servant of your kingdom to deliver exactly what it is that you have for us today as a warning, as well as a prepared insight of what's going to transpire. Father, may our hearts be receptive to the words of the Torah. The words of the Torah of your instructions did not die. The words of the Torah and your instructions, Father, of your covenant was not nailed to the tree. But Father, we thank you for our Messiah, and we thank you for the resurrection and the power and the understanding. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, your Ruach HaKodesh. Amen and amen. So this is a brief outline of this week's Torah portion, beginning in the book of Numbers, chapter 16, verse 1, going all the way to the end of chapter 18. And as you guys can see, there's a lot in these Torah portions lately within the book of Numbers. Bamidbar, can you guys say that? Bamidbar. Which means in the wilderness, but it's really in the place of speaking. It's in a hot place so that we can learn to listen. Fear kept the people from entering the land. This week we see when fear sets in, rebellion is birthed. When fear sets in, fear is the opposite of faith, of emunah. When fear, that type of fear of man, sets in, then rebellion is birthed. And these are things we need to beware of. It was an evil report which doomed that entire generation to die in the wilderness. In Psalms, Tehillim 56 verse 4, it says this, as it's written, in Elohim I will praise his word, in Elohim I have put my trust, I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. In Isaiah, Yeshayahu 43:1, it is written, it says this, but now thus saith Yahweh, that created you, Jacob, and he that formed you, Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you, and I have called you by name, you are mine. That alone, I can go home with just that alone, knowing that he's called me by name, he's called you by name, and that we belong to him. Beautiful. This is our 38th Torah portion. And from this very point on, it will be a total of 38 years that the children of Israel would remain in the wilderness, and that entire generation would wind up dying off. So it's very, very interesting how these numbers all connect with what's going on with Torah portions. Rebellion was a result of Korah's coveting the priesthood. He wanted Aaron's position. The Hebrew word for rebellion is moreh, which means rebellion or bitterness. But when you read it backwards from left to right, letter by letter, we actually have a picture, which is this. The hand raised up against the head. So you have a hand that is raised up against the very leadership that the Father has placed in position amongst Israel. When we read the paleo or pictographs, we have the hand that brings chaos against the head. So you see, sometimes we might not like an individual that the Father raises up. We might believe, you know what, I can do it way better than that person. Or I can do this better. You probably can, but there's a specific anointing. There's something specific that Yahweh places in an individual to accomplish a certain task that is not your assignment. We need to remember that. Not only is this the 38th Torah portion, but there's 94 verses in this Torah portion, which is a lot for some, but not for many. 94 is the value of another Hebrew word, which is ha-ayin. Can you say that? Ha-ayin, which is found in Genesis of Bereshit 15:11, where Abraham drives away the birds of prey. So there's 95 verses in this Torah portion, which is the value of the word ha-ayin, which is the word in Hebrew for birds of prey. Korah and the assembly wound up being as birds of prey to hinder the process of what Yahweh had intended for all of Israel. And remember, it was at this time in Genesis 15 that Abraham was getting ready to receive a ratification of the blood, of the covenant that Elohim was giving to Abraham in promise for the descendants of Israel that would wind up coming forth later on. Rebellion must be driven away from the midst of the covenant people of Yahweh. Do you guys agree with that? Should rebellion be driven away? Yes. If we look at some movies like the Gladiator movies, the Troy, and all these movies with these warriors in there, some of the things we see in there are pretty brutal. When you see them battling the enemy, chopping heads off and killing them, briefly showing it. But it's real interesting how Yahweh instructed Levites and certain individuals of Israel, when rebellion came out, the way they were to handle the rebellious ones was very brutal as well. Doesn't mean that we do that today, even though sometimes people might have that thought cross their mind when certain situations rise up. I know a pastor, he said this, he plays Xbox a lot. I don't, I've never even touched that, that's just me. And he says that on his Xbox game, there's he puts names to people that he's shooting. And that kind of relieves the stress that he has with people in his church. But that's him, and we gotta pray for him. But rebellion is like a spiritual cancer that, if not removed, can destroy a body or a community of believers. We need to understand that. Rebellion is like a spiritual cancer that can destroy the entire body. And there's a question for you guys. If you can't blurt it out in 1 second, forget it. We'll move on. What is rebellion according to the scripture?
Witchcraft.
Is rebellion not going to Sunday service? No. Is rebellion not attending the Christmas or Easter celebrations? Not attending that is rebellion. Johnny. Been drinking? No, just kidding. No. Not attending a Wednesday night, Tuesday night, Thursday night Bible study. Is that rebellion? No, it's not. That's not rebellion. If you don't go to church, if you don't come to an assembly, that's not called rebellion. Even though the scripture says, do not forsake the assembly of ourselves together, we should not, because when we're alone and secluded and isolated, that can actually veer us away sometimes without someone with greater wisdom that can help keep us in place. We all need to be accountable. But here's rebellion. Rebellion is exactly what Korah shows us. Usurping the authority of Moses and the prescribed priesthood and wanting to change the order of Yahweh, which is the sprinkling of witchcraft in the midst of a congregation of people. Today this is happening worldwide. We have genetic manipulation, replacement theology, the alien embrace instead of fellow human beings, and a priesthood manipulation all going on right now. Which priesthood are you going to serve? The Melek Tzaddik or something else? It's up to you. Something for you to think about. In Korah, Torah portion Korah, Numbers chapter 16, verse 1, it says this: Korah rose up before Moses. Rose up before him. Pride and ambition can easily give way to slander and rebellion. There's nothing wrong with being ambitious for something, but when it comes out of the gates of its control, it can turn into best friends with rebellion. Yeshua said in Matthew 5:3, blessed are the poor, the contrite in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom, the Malkhut of heaven. Those who have a humble spirit. And in Matthew 20:27, it says this: and whosoever will be chief among you, let him be a servant to everybody else. Let him get away from the coolness of the moment. Let him turn the fans to the congregation instead of himself. Let him be in a more uncomfortable position. Let him be the servant of everyone. Otherwise, he's really not a leader of anything. How easy it is to become displeased with those who Yahweh has chosen to be leaders and to fall into the sin of Korah. Yahweh curses those who use their mouths to try to destroy godly leadership even when they're wrong. Even when they're wrong. Some might say, well, wait a minute. No. Even when they're wrong. Even when something is true, it can still be Lashon Hara just because something actually transpired. And remember, Korah is a relative. That means he was someone close. He was actually part of Levi's lineage. So the first verse in three different translations say this. In the Institute for Scripture Research, it says this. And Korah, son of Yitzhar, son of Kehat, son of Levi, Lui, took both Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and On, son of Pelet, sons of Reuben. In the King Jimmy Version, or the King James Version, it says, now Korah, son of Yitzhar, the son of Kohath, the son of Levi, and Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and On, the son of Pelet, sons of Reuben, took men. The Tanakh says this, Korah, son of Yitzhar, son of Kohath, son of Levi, separated himself with Dathan and Abiram. And it's no coincidence that they all camped right next to each other in the south. So that means they were planning something for a long time. Hold on, here comes Moses. Baruch Hashem. That kind of quiet. You guys can smile. Just fake it. Just fake it. Korah didn't just take some men with him, but he separated himself from the congregation of Israel with these three leaders. Men of renown of the tribes of Reuben and Zebulun. These tribes were neighbors during the wilderness encampment. He separated his heart and mind, and this is his plan for the rest of Israel. This tells us that this rebellion was something that was premeditated. Something premeditated, and then it transpired. In Proverbs Mishlei 18:1, it says, he that separates himself seeks his own wisdom and contends against all sound wisdom. There's a time for separation, and then there's a time to come out from that separation and come amongst the community of people. This is scripture. There is a time when we should come to the place known as isolation, which is, in Hebrew is called hit bodedut. Say it. Hit bodedut, which means a secluded place between you and Yahuwah during a time of fasting and prayer. That's different. The word contends is the Hebrew word galah, which means to break out in contention, to lay bare, to uncover. Same meaning of Korah's actual name, which means bald or to remove the covering. The Hebrew word yitgalah, with the added letters in yellow, the yud and the ta, that's why we had that crash course in the beginning, gives it a potential future rebellion that will transpire. Very interesting. Rebellion is usually birthed while a person is isolated with another agenda. This is not good. This is not tov in Hebrew. Tov means this is not functional. It is not functional. It's not good to just be isolated all the time. It's not good. It's not a balance of your spirit man and the physical man. The Father brought us into the world amongst other human beings to make connections. However that's going to transpire. But even making certain connections, we got to use wisdom. You don't go and pet a serpent the way you pet a dog or a cat. So we got to use wisdom. The value of this Hebrew word is 513, which gives us a specific phrase found in Genesis 2:18 in connection with Adam, where it said, Yahweh says, it's not tov, it's not functional for the Adam to be alone. Very, very interesting. So this future rebellion is also tied into a phrase out of the mouth of the Creator, that it is not good for Adam to be alone. It's not good for someone to be alone all the time, because a coldness like a Korah can set in on them if it's not controlled. We need to understand that. The scripture declares a future apostasy or a rebellion or a falling away. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, it says this, let no one deceive you. First and foremost, we need to be so in tune with what His Word says that we don't need to be so familiar with counter-theology, counter-religious practice. We don't need to be so in tune with that. We need to be very well aware of the truth so that when a counterfeit arises, you can identify it immediately. That doesn't line up with the real one. And like Brad Scott has said, one of his brother-in-law or someone's an FBI agent, they don't train you how to identify a counterfeit. They just make sure you're completely familiar with the real thing so that when a counterfeit rises up of, like, say, a $100 bill or something, you can identify it immediately because you spent much time with the real thing. So let no one deceive you in any way, because the falling away is to come first, and the man of lawlessness is to be revealed, the son of destruction. The Greek word falling away, and there's different, you know, views on this word because it's very, very broad meaning, is apostasia, where we get the word apostasy from. And it means a defection from truth, a divorcement, to forsake, and it even means a writing of divorce. This rebellion will be those who willfully separate themselves from the truth and relationship of Yeshua HaMashiach in the end. You see this culture that we're in now, everyone is just pulling further and further away from just simple morality. Simple things that are normal 60 years ago, 50 years ago, things that were normal between a man and a woman and a family are no longer the normal thing. Everything is distorted. Why? Humanity is pulling further and further away from the very standard of what the Father says in Scripture. So we see Korah separates himself from all of Israel and desires the position of a high priest. Korah represents an end-time rebellion that will happen among all of Israel. In verse 1, the names represent different aspects of the end-time Israel and those that are in the midst. Example is Yitzhar. We have the Yud and the Tzahar. This is the grandfather of Korah. Tzahar means a window or something bright, as you see in Genesis 6:16. The added Yud gives it the concept of an oil being smeared upon an individual. Here's our lineage for Korah. He's from Levi. Here's Levi. And here's all the descendants of Levi. But just because you're a descendant of Levi does not mean you have premise over the one that the Father has chosen to do a specific task, meaning Aaron and his sons. In order to be a high priest after the order of Aaron, just simple logic would tell you, you'd have to be born from the very loins of Aaron himself. Right? That's simple logic. All these others are Levites, but that doesn't give them free reign. In Jude chapter 1, which is only one chapter, it says, "For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men, who turned the grace of our Yah, of our Lord, into lewdness and denied the only Master Elohim and our Master Messiah Yeshua." But I want to remind you, Jude is saying, though you once knew this, that the Master, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. These dreamers defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. But these speak evil whatever they do not know, and whatever they know naturally, like brute beasts. In these things they corrupt themselves. Woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and have run greedily in the error of Balaam for profit and perished in the rebellion of Korah. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lust and their mouth with great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Adonai, Messiah Yeshua, how they told you that there would be mockers in the last time, who would walk according to their own ungodly lusts. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. Not recognizing your leaders and not honoring those Yahweh has ordained will end up in personal rebellion. We've actually seen that here. People have said, you know what? No, we got another plan. In the book of Acts 8:29 and 13:4, you guys read that on your own. Did you know that the Holy Spirit or the Ruach HaKodesh determines to whom you're assigned and geographically what direction that you will fellowship. How many times have we ever thought of that? Where your gift and manifestations will wind up flourishing. Rebellion against all of the above mentioned brings depression, and depression is proof that the Holy Spirit has removed itself from your life. You should never be in a state of depression. If you feel that coming on, immediately call somebody so they can pray with you. Depression is proof that the Holy Spirit has just retracted from you for some reason. Korah, son of Yitzhar. Korah means to be made bald, to become as ice. The first time this name is mentioned is way back in Genesis 36, verse 5, in connection to Esau. Esau. The father of this Korah was Oholibama. And I'm not trying to be funny. That's one of the names in the scripture. Not Oholi Obama, but this is the name of this person. I think one year we were like, oh my gosh, this guy's president and his name's in the Bible. Korah was one who became cold as ice. So let's look at this. Korah equals 308, but the letters of his name are very telling when you bring them all together. It means to rise up against the head of leadership and be cut off. Korah's name. The Kuf means to rise. The Resh and the Het means spirit. So Korah's name also means the rising up of another spirit. There's always going to be that potential of another spirit rising up in the midst of Israel, trying to pull and lead people in all these different directions. When the children of Israel saw the giants in the land, when they could have said, we are like flies in their sight. Or they could have said, you know what, we're like fleas to them. But isn't it amazing they said, we're like grasshoppers. I wonder why they said that. I think because they were bouncing around too many places instead of sitting put where the Word of God was their instruction. .308 gives us two words that I wanted to look at. One is shuv, which means to return, to repent. Korah hinders people with that fiery passion to continue on their journey of repentance. Korah say, hold on, don't go that direction, go this way. And everything shifts. That's Korah. 308 is the value of Eleazar, which is a derivative for Eliezer, which is a parallel to the word Ruach HaKodesh, which is the Holy Spirit. So Korah also represents the rebellion against repentance, returning to the Torah and the ways of Yahweh. After you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, come to know Him for who He is fully as Yeshua. HaMashiach, your master, not your homie. Yeshua's your master, not your homeboy. I had a discussion with someone one time. Jesus is my homeboy. I said, no, He's not. I said, He's either your master or He's nothing to you. You don't bring Him down to that level. Well, He relates to me like this. No, He relates to you as a master and as a loving father will speak through. He is the Word of God. He's not a homie. Yes. Yes. That's right. I mentioned these numbers here. I was just looking through this. There's 250 that rebelled. Korah's name is 308. Which actually brings us to a number 558, which gives us the connecting value also of the word for divination and witchcraft. Kesem is a word for witchcraft as well. But the 558th verse in our scripture finds its place in Genesis 22 verse 10, where Abraham stretches forth his hand to slay the son of Isaac. So you see, Korah also will cause people to turn from the very work of redemption. Korah will cause people to grow cold to the work that the Messiah did when He shed His blood. Meaning this, that the very passion and desire they had when they first came to the knowledge of that, they go a completely different direction and they find themselves cold as ice the way Korah's name means in the in pertaining to the things of God. 558, when you bring that number down to its final little number here. As you guys can see, the way we have this, the mispar katan, it's a Hebrew rendering of adding the numbers all the way down. It has a pregnant meaning of 666, the very number that was attached to the things we talked about last week. In this portion, and even in the upcoming days, Korah wanted the priesthood. The priesthood is the earthly connection to the spiritual world. We need to understand this. The priesthood is like a portal to the heavenly things above. Korah, which also means Keriach, which means to be bald, to be cold as ice, it also means to remove plants from where they have been planted. That means where the Father has brought you and you covenant to be planted somewhere, you don't just get uprooted because someone said this over here or you heard this thing or this. Stay planted so your roots can grow deeper until the time of your flourishing is manifest. Otherwise, what happens when you keep uprooting a plant and you keep trying to change it? It's going to wither away and die sooner or later. Korah whispers in the ears from a distance exaggerated things that can cause you to become cold as ice towards the ones that Yahweh has connected you to. Korah is always after the leadership he sets in doubt, and you won't see it coming until it has taken residence inside of you. Deep words of warning. This is Korah again, 308, which gives us a phrase, Iatzcha Kohenim HaGadol. I will give you counsel by the high priest. This is what he wanted. This is what Korah wanted. He wanted to be high priest. Taking it even further, we see the connection to trees with the Hebrew word Iatzcha. It comes from the very root of it, pun intended, for the word trees. Trees are another word for counsel. One of the very things distinct that Yahweh asked of pertaining to the last week's Torah portion in the land, are there trees or not? In essence, he asked if there was good counsel in the midst of where the people are. We can give advice. We can give good counsel on matters others don't know about. But when it comes down to it, you will either take the counsel or learn on your own. And sometimes the learning brings heartache later on down the line. We've seen it. When it comes to community, we need to be committed to Yahweh and accountable to each other or not, especially in these last days. Because of the golden calf, we understand that a priesthood was imposed upon the nation because of transgressions, Galatians 3:19. So watch out for those Korahs that try to sneak in and come against the handpicked servants of Yahweh. Are you a tree or are you just a piece of wood waiting to be placed in the fire to keep your enemies warm? Are you a tree that's rooted and grounded or are you just a piece of wood that one day the very thing you think is your friend is going to use you as the firewood to keep themselves warm because of their coldness like Korah? I know. I could hear you thinking. Words to think about. The first characteristic of Korah is he was a taker. Pay attention to this, very interesting. It says, and Korah took, Vayikach Korah. Can you say Vayikach? Korah. And Korah took. We're going to look at something that you have to know your Hebrew grammar to catch this. This is very interesting. He is one who is out for himself and seeks his own glory. Korah is one who not only takes, but he separates from within by his words. He's very stealth. We are not to bring division in the congregation. We are to bring about unity without hindering, listen, without hindering the independence of other people as well. So there's a fine line of being connected to a community, and then the leader has no business being controlling to where he hinders the very independent gifts of a person and smothers those because he doesn't want them doing anything. I've said this when we started, I don't own anybody. I don't even own my wife. I don't own my children. I, as the husband and father, and as the pastor slash rabbi of this congregation, have only been trusted with the people that come in and out of here. My duty is to be a servant and to be transparent and real. That's why at the end, I'm going to make a confession to you guys of something that has hindered this congregation. But as of today, it is going to come to an end. And it takes a true leader to not hide stuff. It takes a true leader to stand up and say, you know what? I messed up right here. Don't let your mind go wandering off. It ain't like, oh my gosh, what did this guy do? Let me get out of here now. Erica says, I just brought my husband. John, what are you doing? It's not as bad as you think, but it's something. I'm easy to work with. Tell me something that'll help me grow. Because you know what? A true leader should always remain teachable. If someone's on their high horse, no. What'd you say? Oh yeah, I read that about 45 times. I got it. Or no, I know this, or I know that. No. Tell me something again. We should be teachable. Looking at the very first word of the first verse in our Torah portion, Vayikach, the first word. I want to ask you guys, not my wife and children, because I shared this with them already. Something's missing out of the Torah. Someone removed something from the scriptures. Or Yahweh Himself intended something to be missing, to teach us something very powerful. He intended something to be missing. And let's look at this. The direct object after this word here, the direct object is missing from the Torah portion that nobody talks about. Not even the rabbis. I've read several commentaries. They don't even mention it, but they know it's true. After the phrase, and he took, we have an open space with something missing. Korah took the hearts. It's left open for you to let your mind understand and fill in the gap right there. And I'll show you how that's supposed to look in a second. But Korah took the hearts of the people that followed him. And he used smooth words that lured them away. He enticed them with a false hope of leadership outside of their ordained position. He cloaked them with his own ambition. He built a bunch of persuasion to become popular. Korah was building his own kingdom. He was attempting to build Exodus 19:6, which says this, Mamlechet Kohanim, which Yahweh says, you shall be a kingdom of priests. Or better yet, it says, from kingdom comes forth priesthood. That's why Yeshua taught kingdom all the time. It says, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. Why? Because from kingdom comes the true priesthood. What he wanted was to steal the hearts and the minds of the people. So, Vayikach Halev HaKoach is what should have been there. Meaning this, and he took the hearts and the minds of the people. That's what Korah does. He captivates your mind. He captivates your heart, and he lays out eloquently. I'll bring it down to this, like this. He lays out these beautiful numerical connections and these root strong numbers, and he'll bring all this beautiful enticing stuff from the scripture, which is awesome. But yet in the backdrop, there's an agenda. Just poke that person. You can. I've been poked. I've been stabbed, backstabbed. I've been poked. So you can poke me. It's no big deal. I got you. That's fine. That's your prerogative. That's how you feel. That's how you want to see things. That's all. I'm easy to work with. If someone sees something different from me, I'm not going to say, nope, that's wrong. You're wrong, buddy, because I've been studying this for 2 weeks now. I'm right and you're wrong. Doesn't work like that. I'm easy to work with. But a Korah, you poke them the wrong way, they're going to attack. Something's going to come out, and all hell's going to break loose, and you're going to wish it didn't. Korah is the group who will deny the head by trying to empower another priesthood. When it comes to you as an individual, you fill in the gap between Vayikach and Korah. We'll look at that later on. So in Numbers 16, 1 through 35, we have like kind after like kind. Two groups of rebellious people. Korah, who is seeking the high priesthood, and Dathan and Abiram, who are looking for earthly, carnal pleasures. Two different groups with two different agendas. I got this and you, just help me get this and I'll help you get that. And our plan's going to come to pass. And in the end, who cares about Moses and Aaron? So two different groups with two different agendas, and they both come together and they hook up for one completely unholy rebellion against the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Korah was a taker and not a giver. And note the opening words, once again, Vayikach Korah. Hebrews 5:1 says this, that no one can take the priesthood. You have to be appointed, born into it. For every priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men in matters related to Elohim to offer both gifts and offerings of sin. Verse 3, they gathered together against Moses and Aaron and said to them, you take too much upon yourselves, for all the congregation is set apart. Every one of them, and Yahweh is among them too, who made you to be like this? Why then do you exalt yourself above the assembly of Yahweh? Moses heard and fell on his face. The entire nation, with the exception of Caleb and Joshua, had just been sentenced to die in the wilderness, last Torah portion. They'd just been sentenced to die. So this is harboring in their minds and their hearts. And Korah stirring this up. Hey, don't you guys know, guess what? We're not going to the promised land under that priesthood there. Exciting, right? We're not going to make it. The little ones are, but guess what? We're not, so guess what we need to do? Let's create our own priesthood and do things all over again. Let's open up a different door. Forget Moses. Look at him. Look how old he's getting. Aaron, Aaron might just try to make another calf or something. This is Korah. Very sneaky. So the conditions were definitely ripe for rebellion against Moses' authority. The first thing Moshe does as a leader should do instead of retaliation. And I'm going to tell you, it's tough when you hear something third hand, a false accusation about yourself. You're like, what? How easy it is to retaliate physically. But a true leader says, you know what? I used to have this when I was working on the railroad yard. I had backslidden for 7 years. So in the railroad yard, I dealt with guys that were tough guys. So I had to be tough. And there's things I did that I got in trouble for, but you had to be tough. It was like a prison on the railroad yard because 80% of the guys just came out of the joint. Some pretty tough guys, Bloods, Crips, you name it. Pueblo Bloods that don't get along with the other Bloods. You know, all this crazy, pretty intense. I became friends with a lot of guys. Because I was transparent and respected where they were at as well. But we need to understand that there is a rebellion that will rise up in the midst of this. And taking it back, I had this little blue car. It was a Champ. It was real tiny. And on my license plate, after I committed myself back to God to serve Him, instead of doing things with my hands, I had a license plate that said, fight like a real man, get on your knees and pray. And see, that's what Moses did. He fought like a true leader and he got on his knees and he began to pray. We can probably crack that door, get that breeze if that other door's open, that's fine. I'm not bothered by it because I know you guys are hot. I'm burning up here. Oh, my breathing's too loud, sorry. Oh, not all the way, just a little bit cracking. No, I'm fine. All right, so look at it. So the first thing Moses does is he falls on his face. Do you seek the Father first when there is a rising up against you, or do you rise up against them? Moses then reacts, or I should say responds quickly to the rebellion with a miracle of judgment. to prove the authenticity of his authority. In verse 28, Moses said, "By this you shall know that Yahweh has sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them by my own will. If these men die naturally like all men, or if they are visited by a common fate by all men, then that means Yahweh has not called me. But if this transpires, if the earth opens up and swallows them up, then you need to understand that these men have rejected Yahweh and they were judged because of what they had done." Remember, we discussed about Reuben, which meant to see a son. And no, it was Korah who joined himself with the descendants of Reuben. And we're going to wind up looking at Reuben winds up losing his firstbornhood because of what he had done. Reuben loses his firstbornhood. 1 Chronicles 5:1. "Now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, he was indeed the firstborn physically, but because he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given to the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel, so that the genealogy is not listed according to the birthright." So you see that when there's a fault, one who has an ambition to overtake something that doesn't belong to them, hook up with people who have a common thread connection of a problem in jealousy and covetousness, it will bring forth rebellion. It'll bring forth rebellion every time. And then we have mention of the 250 leaders. These were not just nobodies. From the various tribes, these men were likely also firstborns who had watched their priestly position get handed over to the Levites because of what transpired. But Midbar 3:12 says, "Now behold, I myself have taken the Levites from among the children of Israel instead of every firstborn who opens the womb among the children of Israel. Therefore the Levites shall be mine." Sounds like a whole bunch of jealousy going on, huh? At the pinnacle of Korah's words, we see this in verse 3 of chapter 16. "And they were assembled against Moses and against Aaron and said to them, 'You take too much upon yourself,' as we had just read." The echoing influence of Korah speaks through these 250 men. It is no longer these guys, it's Korah speaking through them. When someone does this type of stuff, the characteristics of Korah, and you hear someone else speaking or doing the same thing, that's not them anymore. That's this person over here. They just multiplied themselves. They give birth to them in an unholy way. Be mindful that this Korah type spirit that can trap you into speaking and thinking ill towards the very ones Yahweh has placed in your life. Korah began to remove himself and isolate himself. And this can be dangerous if you do not have a community to keep you accountable. We see the difference between the wise and the wicked. The wise believe you that you have to be part of the body, but the wicked are always trying to separate themselves from the body. Hey, you don't have to go to Shabbat. Stay home, you're cool, you're good. You don't know, you don't have to be amongst, you just do your own thing at home. You gotta watch that. Korah tried to exalt himself above the head, which was Yahweh, and assert the ordained leadership. Korah found an excuse to challenge the legitimacy of Moses. When you do this, it's a very short step to denying the divine origin of the commandments of Yahweh and his Torah. Korah had the problem of what's called Torot Ra'ah, which is the Torah of recognition, and the Torot of Kavod, which is the Torah of honor. He could not show honor and recognition where he was supposed to. This was the root problem of Korah. He did not accept the position ordained leadership of Israel. He wanted all of it. So not recognizing your leaders will result in rebellion. Doesn't mean you have to put people on pedestals. We're not supposed to do that. You don't elevate them and do all these things that some big churches and ministries do. That you don't, the untouchables, that you can't even come near someone because their anointing's protected. Watch out for that person who's trying to shake my hand. No, they need prayer. They're dying. What are you doing? You're anointed. You're supposed to pray for them. Yes. But you got 4, 5, 6 rows of bodyguards. Armor bearers keeping you protected from this little old lady that needs prayer. And I'm telling you about something that I was involved with. I wasn't just a usher and then an armor bearer. I was the bodyguard for a pastor. And I see this even in the big healing crusades. I was a helping bodyguard for Suzanne Hinn. And a little old lady came walking up and that needed prayer. And I was helping her come to the front. And this cop or FBI guy that was off duty, he came and said, "What are you doing?" I said, "This lady needs prayer. We need to get her to the front of the line." He says, "Where's your post at?" I said, "Over there." He says, "You left your post." I said, "No, everybody's gone." I said, "I'm over here now." I said, "She needs prayer." He says, "No, send her back. There's no room." I was turned off from that moment on. If you got an anointing in your life, it does not need to be protected. It needs to be contagious. It needs to flow out like a river. It needs to touch the lives of everybody around you. If you're not anointed, then what you're really protecting is your own thing, is your own game.
That's right. Come on.
Your own fried chicken recipe, or your...
Oh, yes, yes.
Your own fish chowder recipe or something like that.
That's right, come on.
I don't even know where that came from. That was kind of weird. Moses didn't just hear what the rebellious uprising had said. It said Moses heard. Moshe understood the very deceptive goal of these rebellious ones. If we want to be part of what Yahweh is doing, then we must come in line with His plans, not our own. And this is why we study the Torah and the prophets. The prophets were given for those who are in exile. We can learn a lot through the prophetic word of Scripture. Not so-and-so super master prophet coming from this direction. Never heard of a master prophet ever. So may I suggest to you that there will be a group of individuals at the end of the age that were in church doing all the churchy stuff, but either were never taught about the Torah and the priesthood, or just outright rebelled against the Torah and the priesthood. And taking it further, there will be those who know the Torah and choose a different priesthood to follow. Matthew 7 says this: "Not everyone that says to me, Adonai, Adonai, Hashem, Hashem, Yahweh, Yehovah, Yahuwah, or Yahweh, shall enter with me into the Malkhut Hashemayim, the kingdom of heaven. But he that does the will of my Father, my Abba, who is in the heavens. A great many will say to me in that day, Master, Master, I cast a demon out of my friends. I prophesied in your name. I healed all the... I did all this. Me!" And a still small voice says, "So you wasted your whole time thinking you did something. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity," which is Torahlessness. "I never knew who you were. But I did all these miracles. I even had this big Thursday once a month thing where we had these healing type things, people coming in from all over. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you." Numbers 16:5 says this: "And he spoke to Korah and to all his company." It's going to get really crazy in just a minute. Very, very weird in just a minute. I've been pretty weird these past several weeks now. We've been just really pulling out some crazy stuff that's happening. Well, just hold on, because it's going to happen again. All right, look at it. "And he spoke to Korah and to all his company, saying, In the morning Yahweh will know who are his, and him who is set apart or holy, and shall cause him to come near him, even him who he has chosen. He will cause to come near to him. Do this, take fire pans for yourself." I think it was Jim Staley saying, people are always attracted by the fire of the Holy Ghost. And there's a counterfeit fire of the Holy Ghost out there. What we need is the consuming fire of the Ruach HaKodesh that consumes every part of what Galatians 5 says about our filthiness of our human nature. That's the fire we need in order to do something great for His kingdom. So do this, take fire for yourselves, Korah and all his company, and put fire in them. And put incense on them before Yahweh tomorrow. And it shall be that the man whom Yahweh chooses, he shall be holy. First, they didn't even want to follow, do anything Moses said. And Moses says, here, go take fire pans. They're doing what he said. They don't even see it coming. It's right out of left field. We don't want to do anything he said while they're doing exactly what he said right here. You take too much upon yourselves, you sons of Levi. At this point, we have an identifying point. Moses didn't have to do it, but he identifies them as being sons of Levi, a reminder of something for them. And Moses said to Korah, "Hear now, you sons of Levi. Is it too little a thing to you that the Elohim of Israel has separated you from the congregation of Israel to bring you near to himself, to do the service of the tabernacle of Yahweh, and to stand before the congregation to minister to them? That wasn't good enough for you, Korah? You wanted more." So Korah stirs up the men of position and begins to cause a division. Korah influences others to speak up against the ordained leadership. And while all this is happening, Korah's plan is his position to take on the high priest. The influence of Korah is to keep you from being part of the community of the body. They might have said something like this. Look at this. "We don't need them. We all stood at Sinai. We are all holy people. We don't need to be instructed about God." But you are. "We all heard his voice, and it remains for each of us to find his own private way of deepening the relationship. There's no reason why we cannot do so without taking orders from some tyrannical leader like Moses." Verse 10, "And he has brought you near to him, and all your brothers, the sons of Levi, with you, and now you seek the priesthood." Also, he exposes the very thing Korah was after. He exposes their entire agenda. "For which cause both you and all your company are gathered together against Yahweh. And who is Aaron that you murmur against him?" And Moses sent to call Dathan and Abiram. This was their opportunity to turn around, but there's somebody missing. The sons of Eliab, who said, "We're not coming up." And this is actually an unwitting prophecy for the future time. "Is it a small thing that you have brought us up out of the land that flows with milk and honey?" We need to slam on our brakes, full pressing those brakes right there. Wait a minute. They twisted the words of the promise in 1 Peter 3:16 and also of Paul in his letter, speaking of the things in which some things are hard to understand, which they are unlearned and unstable, twist as they do also the other holy writings to their own destruction. They called Egypt the land flowing with milk and honey. They twisted it. "You took us out of the land flowing with milk and honey." How deceptive. How many people are going to say that when all hell starts breaking loose? "I need to go back to the land of milk and honey. We had, my gosh, you know, this, I can't deal with no wilderness time. I need a Starbucks drive-thru, man. See, coffee bean, I need all these things. I need stuff catered to me. Please, now. I don't need Moses in my life. I don't need Moses. I had it better when it was really easy. I became a god. To kill us in the wilderness, except perhaps to make yourself a leader over us? Moreover, you have not brought us into a land that flows with milk and honey, or given us an inheritance of fields and vineyards. Will you now put out our eyes like these men? Will you not come up?" And Moses was very angry and said to Yahweh, "Respect not their offerings. I have not accepted anything of theirs." And you can read in Amos chapter 5, the whole chapter 5, you see a parallel to this. Moses says, "I haven't touched anything, Yahweh. Don't accept anything that they have to say or have to offer." That tells me that the anointing on the priest, if he still brought what was ordained by Yahweh, it had to be accepted by Yahweh. Because that's what was prescribed and commanded and instructed. And what does Moses say? They have a good way of trying to draw near because the laws you placed in this earth. But Yahweh, don't accept it. Those are some heavy words from a human being to the Creator of all things. Later on, there will be a very key person in Scripture named Samuel that comes from the lineage of Korah. And what some of the sages have said, that Korah paused, and it's always reworded different. He paused and he put his head down in the midst of all this for a fraction of a second probably. And he was given an open vision that one day Samuel the prophet's going to come from your loins, but Korah, you're about to go to hell. And I'm going to let you hear your great-great-great-great-grandson's words in 1 Samuel 15:23. Rebellion, Korah, is the sin of witchcraft. Korah heard that. He was opened up to those spiritual things. So Korah gathered two specific people that would lead in this rebellion, Abiram and Dathan. So we have these three men of influence. So let's look at these names. Check this out. Look at this. Abiram, Dathan, and Korach. Notice the words highlighted. This is so fascinating. It's going to get really awesome right now. When we take the first letters of these names, we can see the energy behind what they have done. There's always an energy behind what we do. If it's just walking, or if it's doing weights, or if it's running, if it's sitting, if it's speaking, there's always an energy behind everything they do. And there's an energy behind every single letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So pay close attention. Because inside of Korah was the spirit of the beast in the future. Here you have a prophetic picture of the Antichrist, the false prophet, and the beast himself. Wow. The one in the middle, the beast was inside of him. The false prophet is the one Abiram. And the anti-Messiah is inside of Korah. You can only see it in Hebrew. That's why we did the crash course. Olivet, you know, I'm going to pick somebody. I just want you to run it by me again, just so I can remember. Kidding. You know I wouldn't do that, you guys. So look at this. The Aleph equals power, initiating force. The Aleph in front of a word, it speaks of a force that is unstoppable. And it represents leader. Dalet is door, entrance beyond the four dimensions, going into the fifth, sixth dimensions. They say, they talk about 10 dimensions now, but the fifth and sixth dimensions, they say you can time travel. The Kuf is rising up, a channel for light, illumination to ascend above a natural state. These are what these Hebrew letters mean. That's why when you study from a Hebraic perspective, it is so powerful what is extracted out of the text. So the meanings are endless, but their energy is evident. Together, these three Hebrew letters of these three men reveal their ultimate plan. It gives us the Hebrew word adach, which means to fasten or connect together. They were trying to come together, which they did amongst themselves and the 250. And then later on, it's going to go overboard and infect 14,700, giving us a total of 14,953 people that are going to perish first as a first fruits of death in the wilderness, which was never supposed to happen. Their plan was to cause the people to disconnect from Moshe, and attach themselves to this other priesthood. The value of this name is 105, which gives us la kohen, which means to the priesthood. See that? Korah wanted the priesthood in position of authority. They wanted to be the priesthood and have the people connected to themselves. He wanted the people to attach themselves to another priesthood they tried to create. When another priesthood arises, there is something else coming with it. Look at this. Look at the letters in white that are left over, as you guys can see. They give us three words. Biram, which is the Hebrew word for empty spaces, pits, and dimensions. The word Tan in Hebrew is the word for beast or dragon. This is in Abiram's name, Dathan, and Korah. And then you have Ruach, which means spirit. So we have the spirit of the beast is the driving force that comes through the doorway of our four dimensions into this world. Korah was about to open up a forbidden portal that would have changed everything. That's why the earth swallows them up, because of the specific gateway they were about to open up. Rebellion opens up the door to the spirit of the beast. But notice, embedded in Abiram is the word for pits. The earth will open up like a pit and swallow them whole. When we add up the numerical value of these letters with their ordinal values, that means every letter has an ordinal, 1, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, all the way to 22nd, and then 1 through all the way up to 400. When you add up these letters with their ordinal numerical values, it's even more telling. We have a total of 1,019, which gives us the Hebrew phrase found in Genesis 6:4. Ha-Nephilim haya ba'aretz ba'amim ha-hem ve'gam. The Nephilim were in the land, in the earth, in those days and afterwards. This is happening right now. Just email Tom Horn and Steve Quayle and these guys. They'll tell you this is happening now. The Nephilim were in the land then and afterwards. This is going to happen, and it's happening now. After that can be read as end times. So we see this rebellion that rises up in the end times is happening right now. A different priesthood is the focus aside from the Melech Tzadik. The potential of the Nephilim appearing again is due to the beast system that includes another priesthood. And he will be revealed through another priesthood. In chapter 16, verse 12, it says, and Moses sent to call, listen, very important, you guys, for us to understand this. Call for Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and so on and so forth. And they said, we will not come up. How many refuse to come close to Yahweh? There's always a calling. Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, refused to make Aliyah. That means to go up. The word Aliyah that the rabbis use is not the Aliyah we're supposed to come under. We're not supposed to come through the prescribed way of the rabbis in order to be recognized as being Jewish now. We don't have to do that. But the ascending up from this influence, the ascending up from Korah and his mind control, ascend up beyond this complete rebellion. They refuse the call of Moses to come close. Moses represents the Torah, covenant Torah. It is through the Torah that we discover how to draw near. Yeshua is the door, and it is by His blood that we can draw near. James 4:8 says, draw near to Allah, to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hand, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. James 1:8 says, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Moses was reaching out to them to ascend above the double-minded mindset that was birthed because of what Korah planted in their ears. But they refused. Instead, they refused the prescribed way to come close, and they want to come up some other way of their own. Today we see humanity in general refuses to ascend up the instructions given to Moses. That's called humanism. They want and believe there are many paths to Elohim. That's called New Age. In 16:12, look at how it's worded. It says, Vayishlach Moshe likharo le Dathan ve la Abiram. And I put, note the Hebrew letter Lamed. This is so amazing. This is the Lamed here, 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 and here. Now you're going to learn something about the letter. Some of you might know that. Most of you don't. That's so amazing. Lamed as a prefix means two, toward, or four. But Lamed also means to shape, as in the connection to the woman for Adam, as we have seen, for the purpose of existence. Lamed represents to shape and form for the purpose of your being here. Lamed means to lead or to form in the way of the shepherd's teaching. Lamed is an instruction guide for the obedient and a weapon against the rebellious. It will shape you or it will ship you out. The verse says, and he sent, the he is Yahweh, and the what is Moshe, Moses. Torah was sent to them, and instruction was given to them. Torah can lead us out of rebellion, a rebellious way of living that we didn't realize was rebellious.
That's right.
That's why we need it, because it teaches us how to begin our journey out of rebellion, even though we had no idea we were being rebellious in ignorance.
That's right.
And I leave that open. So he sent the Lamed, but they refused it. When Lamed is used as this prefix, it teaches us that what comes after is being called to a purpose, and that the letter Lamed hovers over it to form that person or that place into the very purpose that Yahweh intended it to be. So we see they refused to be elevated into the ideas of Moses, who was set apart by the Holy Spirit, who was sent to teach the principles of the covenant Torah, who we see that Yeshua would later appear to teach these same principles to all of Israel, as seen in Deuteronomy 18, specifically the book of Acts, which says this: repent therefore and turn back for the blotting out of your sins, in order that the times of refreshing might come from the presence of the Master, and that he sends Yeshua Messiah, pre-appointed for you, whom heaven needs to receive until the times of restoration of all matters, of which Elohim spoke through the mouth of all his set apart prophets since of old. For Moshe truly said to the fathers, Yahweh your Elohim shall raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. Him shall you hear according to all matters. Whatever he says, that will you do. And it shall be that every being who does not shema the prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. To hear means to shema. That means, what did you say? That's what I do. Naseh v'nishma. What did he just say? That's what I do. Now you have proof that you have heard. Hebrews 3:8 says, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion in the day of the trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tried me, proved me, and saw my works for 40 years. Therefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. I swore in my wrath, if they shall enter my rest, look out, brothers, lest there be any of you with a wicked heart of unbelief. It's all about belief and unbelief in the midst of this entire situation. Verse 13, is it a small thing that you have brought us up from the land flowing with milk and honey? And they twisted that word. And as I have here, breaking news, America is not the land flowing with milk and honey. They said, to cause us to die in the wilderness. The word wilderness is bamidbar. It comes from the word dabar. In other words, they twisted what the land flowing with milk and honey was. They called it Mitzrayim, which means constriction and torment. They were calling that the land flowing with milk and honey. And then they said, the wilderness, you brought us out here to kill us by the word of God. They twisted everything up. Everything is twisted up. You see what happens when Korah begins to influence, it messes up your entire focus. Everything is wrong. And you don't even know it. It says, take every man his censer. They all brought their censers to the door, right? And Korah gathered the entire congregation against them at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And the glory of Yahweh appeared to all the congregation, and Yahweh spoke to Moshe and to Aaron, saying, separate yourselves from among this congregation, that I might have consumed them in a moment. Come out from among them, my people. Revelation chapter 18, verse 4. Verse 21, speak to the congregation, saying, move away from the tents of Korah. Now here is where it's going to get really weird, and man, I got 30 minutes. Some of you are saying, 30 minutes. Say it like this, 30 minutes, that's it. How many people give me 30 minutes? Raise your hand. 30, 60, 90, I fell for it again. So 30, 60, 90, 120, 150 minutes. You got, anybody else? Going once, going twice. So that's how it goes, right? No. If Ashley was here, she's here, she'd be like this, that was a dud, Dad. All right, so let's stay focused on the Torah portion, you guys. You got to behave. Look at that verse 24 in your scriptures. Here's where it's going to get revealing. Everywhere else, when it's dealing with the children of Israel, the tents are called Ohel. Ohel, Ohel, Ohel. Or the Adach, which is the witnesses. But the tent, the dominant word for tent is Ohel. But with Korah, the wording is completely different. In English, it says tents of Korah. But in Hebrew, it says Lemishkan Korah. The tabernacle, not of Moses, the tabernacle of Korah. Korah had built his own tabernacle. He saw himself as the high priest already. Reminds me of Isaiah 14. I will exalt myself. I will do this. Lucifer Satan will say, I will do this. I will do this and I will do this. Five times is I will. He already seen himself. You know what's scary? It's not the fact that you have strayed from the ways of Yahweh, but when you see yourself in the complete opposite ways of Yahweh and you think it's the right way. When you think you're going in the right direction and in all reality it's not. That's a big deception. So Korah built his own tabernacle. He created his own place of worship, recognition, and his own doorway to the spirit realm. Listen to me now. He wanted the illumination for himself. The Mishkan is a message of the good news. The tabernacle is a message of good news. Korah was really preaching another gospel by building another tabernacle. He wanted the serpent's anointing. What is missing in this Hebrew phrase is the pointer of the direct object, and I'll explain it to you in a minute, which is the Aleph Tav. And I'll show you how this should have been written in Hebrew, but it's not a mistake. The Father left it out to show us something. Aleph Tav speaks of the first, the last, the beginning, and the end. It is the Word of God. It is Yeshua who became flesh. It is Mashiach who took upon himself humanity, who is the first and the last, the beginning and the end of all things. That's why you read in the book of Revelation, it doesn't say, and John, guess what? John, you speak Hebrew, that's it. I am the Alpha and the Omega. What? He would have said, Ani ha'alef ve'hatav. I am the Aleph and the Tav. So the Aleph and Tav is missing from here. Just as our first two words revealed Vayecha Korah, something was missing and we filled in the gaps. Aleph Tav should have been right after Vayecha, and Aleph Tav should have been right after the word tabernacle. Korah came to replace the Aleph Tav and all it represents. Korah came to replace everything that Yeshua came to do. That's not real. That's not for you guys. We got something else going on here. Come and join us. As a matter of fact, we're all going to wear blue. Why just wear a little tzitzit? We're going to wear blue. I think it's the heat up here. What did I just do right now? Where am I at? Where are you guys? He wanted to become the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He wanted to become the word of Yahweh for Israel. He wanted the anointing to do what was intended for Moshe to do and what was imposed upon Aaron to do while they journeyed through the wilderness. Speak to the congregation saying, move away from the tents. Lemishkan Korach. It doesn't even have it in the plural. It's singular. Move away from the tabernacle of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Lemishkan Korah. The Hebrew phrase should have looked like this. Now look at the difference. You see the difference? Lemishkan et Korah. That's how it should have. The Hebrew grammar should look like that. Where there's another Mishkan, another message, or another way of illumination, the Aleph Tav will never be there. The first and the last, he's not in that. Aleph Tav is the word manifest. Yeshua is the word manifest. La Mishkan equals 748, which gives us the value of Mishkat, which means the anointing. He wanted the anointing. Behind Korah was the influence of a fallen, anointed cherub known as Lucifer, Satan himself. Korah deceived many with another good news. Another good news means there's another way, or all paths lead to the supernal being. This is the lie. Corinthians 11:4. For if indeed one comes to you proclaiming another, that means a deceptive or different Yeshua, whom we have not proclaimed, or if you receive another, an altered or distorted spirit, which you have not received, or another altered or distorted good news, which you never accepted, you might have listened to him. I am surprised at how some of you have turned to another good news away from the Messiah who has called you to grace, a good news which does not even exist. Howbeit, there are men who have stirred you up and want to pervert the good news of Messiah. But even if we are a cherub out of heaven, isn't Satan called the anointed cherub? Should preach a good news to you beside the good news we preach to you, let him be cursed. The Mishkan was the good news that redemption has come and forgiveness of rebellion was given. The power of the blood, even though it was a temporary thing, nevertheless it pointed to the one Mashiach who would come and redeem all of Israel. The Mishkan was like the firmament in Genesis chapter 1 verse 6. Which says, Vayomer Elohim Yehi. Rakia, listen to this. This is it's just amazing. Now hold on. I get so excited. I start speaking in tongues up here, and you guys don't even understand what I'm saying. So I take a deep breath. Relax, John. I get like a little kid with the word. It's awesome. And Elohim said, let there be a firmament, which means a flattened out space. The Hebrew word rakia represents four-dimensional universe. We live in the three dimensions, which deals with space. The fourth dimension is time. The Rakia was placed between the earth and the heavens as the universe of four dimensions in Genesis 1:6. Korah really had no idea completely of what was happening. There was an entity behind him that was trying to enter this realm from the dimensions of the underworld. This is known. Also known as the underverse. Rakia represents a space itself which is made of dark matter. Dark matter is what they're trying. They're trying to create a black hole over between Switzerland and France with that Hadron Collider. They want to see how everything works. You want to play with black holes? Just stick your head in there. They're after the position of gatekeepers. Keep in mind Psalm 24 because we're going to look at that. We have no idea how big of a problem this was then and even today. This is why Korah was swallowed up by the earth into Sheol. What he was trying to open ended up demanding his presence. Listen to me. The very things you entertain, the doorways you start knocking on that are forbidden, just might open up. And before you can do anything, your repentance might not be logical anymore. And the very doors you open up might demand your presence because of the laws that Elohim put within the universe and the spirit realm. We need to guard ourselves. When looking at the Mishkan of Korah, it has the value of 748. You can see how I just kind of messed this slide up. I was supposed to do that and then the next part, but let's just look at it together. 748 also equals Genesis 2:7, which says, Adam afar mi ha'adama vayipach bepav, the atom of the dust from the ground, and he blew into his nostrils the breath of life. It's all about distorting and becoming the atom of the beginning. It's all about that. The Mishkan is a picture of the atom. Korah tried to recreate the Adam of redemption. This can only be done through the Melchizedek priest himself, who is the last Adam that makes all things functional. Tov. 748 also equals HaTovah Melchizedek Kehunah, which means this, the Melchizedek priesthood makes functional and glorified. Ekadet. Embedded in this. I think that's just powerful. Beautiful. Psalm 24:7. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, O everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? Yahweh strong and mighty. Yahweh mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and even... It is a command. Listen to me. We've sang this song, but this is a command that is going forth of the psalmist. He's being moved in the Ruach HaKodesh. It is a command to the gatekeepers of dimensions and realms. Because the scripture says that the same Yeshua that rose from the dead, that ascended up, shall come back in like manner, and there's going to be a clarion call, a shofar sound that's going to go forth, and the gatekeepers of these dimensions are going to move out of the way of all dimensions that are numerous, and they're going to move, and all the dimensions are going to open up. That's why the heavens are going to zip open like a zipper, and the Messiah himself is going to come riding upon the clouds with power and great glory. So listen.
Hallelujah.
O everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? Yahweh Sebaot of the host of armies of heaven. He is the King of glory. We live in the world of gateways and doorways, and don't forget it. We need to come out of a religious mindset and let's do things like this. And we need to be so in tune with the Ruach HaKodesh and understand that we are not physical people. We are spiritual people. We are spiritual beings dwelling in physical, temporary bodies. We need to adjust our mindset and understand we're not physical people. We're just in this body of death, like Paul says. This is a body of death, but I want to do some, I've worked out too, but nothing wrong with working out, but you get some that they worship themselves. Yes. And they worship themselves, they put on the makeup. That's wrong. See, I'm a guy, I shouldn't know how to put makeup on, right? But like a rabbi says, if you were stranded on an island, there's nothing wrong with like, the old pastor said, there's nothing wrong with painting the barn. Sometimes the barn needs a little bit of painting, right? Remember? Nothing wrong with that. But think about this. If you were on an island with a bunch of baboons and giraffes, would you still take your time to fix yourself up like that and walk out with these baboons and giraffes? Or would you just get up here all crazy looking like this? So we got to ask ourselves, whose attention are we looking for? Yahweh's? Or the person next to us.
Oh, wow. Yes. That's right.
But if the barn needs painting, you know, you gotta paint the barn. You gotta make it last, right? But we live in the world of gateways and doors. It says, lift up your heads, which is Rosh, which means beginning, origins, first formations. Gates is Sha'arim, which means portals of light. Everlasting doors is Pithe Olam, which means doorway, opening, entrance, engraving, possessing the faculty of light is the concrete meaning. So note the first letters of these three words give us two words. Shafa, which means an abundant flow of light. And Sa'if, which means thought. So the mind of Elohim is actually revealed in this Psalm 24. And Korah is trying to manipulate this. This deals with the secrets of all things. And it is a revelation when the gates are lifted up and everything. What does the scripture say? That we will know all things. Because the gateways, gatekeepers are moved out the way and the doors are all open and Yahweh Elohim is going to come in such a way through Mashiach and we're going to know Him like never before. We're going to look at each other and say, my gosh, all those PowerPoints were wrong. And we have to be humble enough to say, you're right. Well, I wrote this book in that book. That was wrong. It's nothing like that. It's much better. Hallelujah. It's not about us. These three Hebrew letters equal 450, which is Tan, which means beast again. The beast system once again desires this sacred knowledge of creation, and this secret is embedded in our DNA. This is why we have always had the battle over our DNA. We have to go a little further here. Look at Jacob seen a gateway, which was the ladder in Genesis 28:17. 15 minutes and I'm done. There is what's called the Ugaritic language. Look it up. It's related to Hebrew and it has single syllables, has 30 characters connected to it. But it's related to the Hebrew language. In this language, the word gate, shagar, in Hebrew means a god of the dawn. This god is really a guardian or the power set in place that allows the dawn to appear. The sages say that the creator is so vast that for even a blade of grass, there's a guardian instructed to watch over even every blade of grass. Because he is beyond our understanding. He can do what he wants. He's expansive. Beyond this universe. So this God is really a guardian of the dawn, or the power behind it set in place that allows the dawn to appear. These are all princes. That is why Satan is called the prince of the power of the air. This is weird. Several people wanted this PowerPoint, Matthew Nolan, David Matthews, and a few other guys. I sent it to them. There's 111 slides on there. And these slide number 70 and 71 would not go through over the airwaves. Satan is the prince of the power of the air, because I'm talking about, we're exposing what gateways are right now. Those two just don't go through. I don't know why. But we know why. I'm not kidding. You can ask Johanna. I said, come here. Here's the email. Here's the PowerPoint. How many slides do you see there? She didn't know how many I had. She goes, 109. I said, how many are on my screen? She said, 111. Two of them, number 70 and 71, won't go through, because we're talking about these immortals right here. There are many princes assigned to the different gateways. In the Septuagint, gates is Archon, which is the word for prince, ruler, principalities. Found in Ephesians chapter 6, eternal gates is the reference of immortal gatekeepers. These gatekeepers control access to this three-dimensional world that we live in. Time and space each have gatekeepers, and these are trying to be accessed today. Today we see the focus in Korah is an encroachment of the priesthood imposed upon Israel. It's true, according to the Jewish Bible. Do not cross these boundaries, of course, right? But going beyond this, we have to go way beyond ancient Near East customs, covenants, and go beyond that, because that's dealing between people and Yahweh, of course, but people. We have to go beyond that. There's something spiritual happening, which is this. It is my conviction that Korah was about to open up a realm of the forbidden. The Mishkan on earth had several gateways and doorways, and only the prescribed priesthood had access into. That's why, you want to hear more about it as well, I have to bear witness, because this is true. I've studied it. Inside the holy place was no longer natural. The menorah was a picture of the solar system. The 12 loaves of bread were a picture of the constellations, right, Andre? The altar of incense was that which goes beyond our known solar system and constellations into an ascending height that you can't go naturally. And then the two veils speak of the seventh heaven, and then beyond that is the tenth heaven where Yahweh is. The tabernacle was a completely spiritual place. So look at this. So the Mishkan on earth had several gateways and doorways. Those born of Aaron's lineage, being born as coming through the womb, or the gateway here, whom Gabriel is the prince. Listen, you women are so beautiful. Your womb, Gabriel is the guardian of your womb. Us men, we don't have a guardian looking after us. Like that. Gabriel is the guardian of the children born into this world. He's examining them, making sure they're not hybrids. Where there's hybrids, he's not the guardian to that. But he stands guard protecting the others. Protecting their spirit. So when we are born again through Yeshua, Yeshua is the prince of the new birth. That's why he's called Sar Shalom. We just throw it around. Sar Shalom, Sar Shalom. Meaning this, he is the prince, the guardian of the new birth. There isn't an archangel that can have that type of authority over the born again experience. None of them have that authority. We enter into the dimension of Melchizedek. So the command to lift up the eternal gates in Psalm 24 speaks of the immortal gatekeepers. Everything has a gateway and a gatekeeper. When Yeshua returns, he will have access to all gateways and doorways. And this is why we will see the sky split and Mashiach coming upon the clouds. The gatekeepers of the Shamayim come as his servants to battle the darkness on this earth.
Yes.
I told you it was going to get very weird, huh? So I'm going to jump ahead. The earth splits and swallows them up. Then we have the rods that bud, and you have Aaron's rod that buds and is placed inside of the Ark of the Covenant. But I want to look at something here. The covering of the ark, right? Excuse me. The covering of the altar is the fire pans of Korah, and then it is flattened down like a firmament inside of the Mishkan. And it is a reminder of the rebellion that Korah had done. But look at this. There's two words for copper or brass. One of them is Nechusha. It's seen 10 times in the scripture. The other one is Nechoshet, the predominant word seen 140 times. Regardless, both of them have the root of Nachash, where we get serpent from. Used as a word for the serpent, or the practice of divination. The fire pans of Korah and the others were intended for set-apart service, but because of the abuse of their position, what was produced was a copper pen of divination. In the New Testament of Brit Hadashah, there is only one time this word is used. Acts 16:16. And it was while we went to the house of prayer. Notice during the time of prayer, the enemy will try and come in. Why? Because we have been given the privilege to open up. We are the gatekeepers of prayer. There's no angel that has that power to be a gatekeeper of prayer. We see in the book of Daniel, we open the gate up of prayer and the angels have to try to defend the darkness that tries to hinder. We hold on this earth the gateway of prayer. How do we know that? Jacob in Genesis 28, he began to pray and it says a ladder went from the earth to heaven. Not from heaven to the earth. Because prayer is the gateway we're in charge of. That's why Yeshua taught that more than anything. He taught the disciples, you must learn how to pray because you can open up domains and portholes that no demon can stop.
Hallelujah.
But no one wants to pray. Now, go taking it further. When you fast and pray now, that makes it even more powerful. You are having access to a dimension that no demon has authority over. That's why when Yeshua said, he said, when you pray, did he say that? When you pray, do it in your mind? Or did he say, when you pray, say. When you pray, speak. Why? Because if you're quiet and you're like this, your mind all of a sudden, you didn't even realize it. 22 seconds later, it's like way over here at lunch. Wait, hold on, let me get back over. Then you try to get back into your prayer, you ain't fooling nobody. But we are the guardians of the dimension of prayer. And it was while we went to the house of prayer, a certain damsel met us in whom was a spirit of divination. Look up this word for damsel. It means a servant of prostitution and divination. And she had produced her overlords much gain by her divination. This is the spirit of divination. Spirit of divination. The scripture says, Luke records, this was a spirit of divination. Some might say, there's no such thing as a spirit of that. Sure it is. The scripture just said it. It means the ruach of Python. The Greek word 4436 is puthon, and it means this from putho, which is the name of the region where Delphi, the seat of the famous oracle, was located. It's where Python, that is inspiration or divination. Now the oracles of Delphi are very telling. Listen, in short, the oracles speak of this spirit of Python as a guardian over the belly button or the center of the earth. What are they doing with the Hadron Collider? They're trying to open up the center of the earth. But look at it, it gets really fascinating. It's a portal. A transition takes place as Apollo, also known as Apollyon or Abaddon, defeats the Python for the mere sake of access to this portal. So the Python's a constrictor of the things of the spirit, but this, in their mythology, they said the spirit of Python was the guardian over the belly button of the earth. But Abaddon came and killed the Python serpent and removed him and had access to the center of the earth, which is the portal to multiple dimensions of the underworld and the darkness and the bottomless pit. Read the book of Revelation, it coincides. Today we have CERN located in this very spot. In this very spot, there was the ancient temple of Abaddon. And this is where they're doing all of this now. As we seen earlier, Korah's name alone has a meaning of the rising up of another spirit. Notice this spirit comes during the times of prayer. If you have the lack of prayer, something Yeshua did the most, there might be the constricting of a Python spirit. If you don't have any desire to pray, that means Python is around your neck. Korah and the others had the responsibility to operate in the prophetic, but turned that into divination. Korah and the others who fell were in a state of rebellion, and Scripture says rebellion is a sin of witchcraft. Scripture says a total of 14,953 people died and were swallowed up by the earth as well. Acts 16:16 happens to be the 14,953rd verse from our Torah portion right here. No coincidence, huh? Delphi, when you see in the Olympics that green little, it's called a laurel crown. That comes from the ancient practices of the defeat of Python. So when we're cheering on our greatest Olympic stars, we're actually getting involved in the pagan practices of this ancient thing. Not even knowing it. And me, I used to love running track. I could still run pretty fast. But track was my thing. I love seeing just that speed, that 100 meter, and that 40-yard dash, or whatever it is, just, I love that stuff. But look at how it's right under our nose. So I'm going to close with this. You guys give me 5 minutes, right? Talking about the tithe, and no, I'm not looking for your money, but there is something here. How do those seeking to obey Yahweh's word fulfill the commanding of tithe? To tithe or not to tithe, that's the question in many people's minds in these days. In light of the misuse of church members' tithes and offerings by many church organizations and ministers for questionable purposes, and in light of the money-grubbing tactics of many Christian media outlets and televangelists, many are now questioning, should we even tithe? These are fair questions and valid concerns, but we're going to look at this right here. To determine doctrine and theology based on our own experience and emotional negativity is a form of humanism, conforming Yahweh's word to fit us. But let's look at Scripture. Before Moses, the tithing principle, it's predated all the way back in Genesis 14, 18 to 20. It's called the Melchizedek type of tithing and offering. The priest of Elohim, according to the book of Jasher and rabbinic tradition, was Shem and the Torah teacher of Abraham. Abraham paid tithes and even vice versa of all that he had to Melchizedek, not just the spoils of war. Abraham honored Yahweh, possessor of heaven and earth, by giving a tithe to Yahweh's servant and likely Abraham's Torah teacher. Genesis 28:22, Jacob tithed all that Yahweh had given him, not just the agricultural goods of the land. During the days of Moses, the tithe system was for the nation of Israel and for the priests that were teaching the Torah of Yahweh, and they were given for the poor and for the Moedim of the year during the days of Moses. The first tithe was to be given to the Levites and to no one else. They in turn gave a tenth of their tithe to the high priest and the sons of Aaron. The first tithe could be converted into money if one paid a 20% penalty. This tithe went to the Levites so that they could devote themselves to the study of the Torah. 2 Chronicles 31:4-5 actually says that. And then to teach what they had learned to the people, that you may learn to fear Yahweh your Elohim always. Ezekiel 44, that you may teach my people the difference between holy and profane. The first tithe went to the Levites, while the agricultural first fruits went directly to the priest in the temple. And so on and so forth. Second tithe, it just keeps going on and on. The Levitical priesthood passed away, and the Melchizedek priesthood is forever. Psalms 110. The Messiah would be of the Melchizedek priesthood, which is an eternal institution. The writer of Hebrews says that Melchizedek was the forerunner of Yeshua. Tithing is not only a physical activity, but an act of worship. And there is no longer a Levitical priesthood, but there remains the spiritual priesthood of Yeshua. Those who choose to teach covenant Torah, we cannot tithe to a Levitical priesthood that no longer exists, which was imposed. Therefore, how do we tithe to Yeshua as Abraham tithed to Melchizedek and Jacob to Yahweh? Yeshua teaches in Matthew 25, 31-40, that if we give to those in need around us, we are giving to Him. If we give to the spiritual body of Yeshua and those who labor in the Torah, we are giving to Him. When we bless those in need around us, we are blessing Yeshua. As Abraham tithed to Yahweh Yeshua through Melchizedek, so we tithe to Yeshua by giving to our local congregation, those in who labor in the Torah for you, the poor, helping those in need, and helping His spiritual body. And I want to just cut it down short to this, that I have to repent, because from the beginning of this ministry, I was afraid to mention tithe because of what we came out of. But I'm telling you, from here on, some of you might not want to be a part of Remnant of the True Congregation, but that's fine. I submit things to our board, and I pray that our board is receptive, but if not, I love them. But when it comes down to it, I have the final say-so under Mashiach with this ministry. We will every Shabbat, for the sake of His kingdom, not for me, accept tithes and offerings for the furthering, because we have struggled too long, for 8 years, kicking rocks. And there's just a couple families here who have been really dedicated to giving the tithes. I have never taught a tithe message ever, but this Torah portion woke me up at 2 a.m. And with this part of this Torah portion, and I sat down beginning to put this part at the end of the Torah portion. But from this moment on, we got a box. We're not going to do a ceremonial thing and put a basket in your face and embarrass you because you might have nothing. Or you might want to be seen saying, here, I got $100 over here. You know, none of that. Whether the less or the greater, our box is there. If you want to tithe and be a part of this, hallelujah. I believe that it's my fault. People make their own choices, that I have robbed you guys. I have robbed the ones that have left because of this very important spiritual principle. Some have said, I ain't giving anything to that guy up there. Well, buddy, you will never give it to me. When you give, you're giving it to him. And the scripture says, I'm not looking for it, but I should expect it as a servant of the kingdom. Yeshua says, do not muzzle an ox when he is treading out the grain. Paul says, I have accepted your gifts as I labor in the word. Those who labor, and I'll tell you this, all glory to Yahweh, but my family and I, for the past 9 years now, we've labored for the kingdom, and I've suffered much. My family has suffered much. But it's time that I repent in front of you guys. And I'm not going to, you won't see us driving a fancy car. Our car's all screwed up. And the other one that we were blessed with took a dump. We got to try to get it fixed, and we have no money to do it. But I'm telling you, from this moment on, I will no longer rob you guys. You will have the opportunity to give, the rest of you. Some of you have been doing it for a long time. Right in that box, because you know what? This ministry is going to do something. We're going to get out of this hot building. We want to get something decent that's comfortable for everybody. But I had to stand here and ask for forgiveness for robbing you guys. Because will a man rob God? I have. By not bringing this part of the Torah in here. And I have told people, you don't have to give your tithe to no one. You could use it all on yourself. In my ignorance, 12, 13 years ago. But when you read the Torah, if you are a Torah teacher, especially under the Melech Tzaddik, you are entitled to be blessed by the congregation. Not to get rich. I'll tell you, anybody that knows me, these clothes that I have are old. And I'll keep using them. Hallelujah. I'm not going to go out buying anything. There's a little dog chewing my shoes up. I'm going to wear them to Shabbat. I want to further what the Father is doing. 100%. I'm not into the flashy stuff, but enough's enough. There's a transition coming in this ministry. There's a youth that is going to rise up, and other families want to come to something that is guaranteed in Yahweh. We've been, just the past month, there's been like an amazing breakthrough connection with families, and there's something getting ready to happen. In here, there's teachers that are here getting ready to be raised up. The Father's getting ready to do something for His kingdom. Why go out less when you could go out with full power, with an army of youth behind the Melchizedek high priest of Yeshua? But as of this day, as I repent and I turn from that rebellion, that was rebellion. Every single Shabbat, that box, you are more than welcome to bless this ministry, because it's a blessing to you, and further what we're doing, because we're on a new path. So beware of the Korahs that might tell you, even with this,
don't listen to him. You don't have to do that.
We are required to follow all of the Korahs. Amen. Bless you guys. Thank you for putting up with this long, hot day. But if you want this Torah portion to go over the whole thing, it is strategically placed in order. It's very, very powerful. I left a lot of things out. You're more than welcome to get it. We have our tzedakah box right there. And I'm going to tell you, I want to see that box bigger for the sake of the kingdom, not for flashy nonsense. For the sake of the kingdom, I want to bring a whole row of people that are homeless in here. Feed them, clothe them, and teach them the Torah of Yahweh. Of women, and do what the Torah says. Not just front row for those that are elect. No, you sit in the back and give your seat up. I want to really be a kingdom congregation. And today we have just made our first step towards this transition. If you're mad at me, I love you anyways. Don't leave yet before your appointed time. And close your ears to Korah. Tell them to get out of here. Alright, blessings. We thank you all.